Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam. This is part 2 from the Quran studies, in which I will discuss a few things. Number 1 is the need of tafsir of Ibn Kathir, and how relevant is it today. Also, the difference between the tunnel understanding and the ocean understanding, and how they can make a whole new world of differences in how you interpret and interact with Al-Quran. I will also discuss here a very strongly and widely misunderstood ayah in the last surah of Surah An-Nas, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, and how this new understanding will make a total sense to you, and you will be even there discover how to derive your own new thinking safely and wisely. And here is part 2.
You see, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as I said at the beginning, He gave the children of Israel the responsibility to safeguard the Torah, and the Christian to safeguard the gospel, but they didn't. So they messed it up. So Allah sent the Quran. But Allah didn't want to give the responsibility to Muslims to protect the Quran, because we will mess it up just like the Jews. Believe me, if it was left to us, the Quran is a messed up book right now. But Allah gave us the protection of the Sunnah, and look what we have today. All the headaches in Islam come from the Hadith. All the headaches. So let's get into rules on how to really work with Quran to design a better now and an awesome tomorrow. Tomorrow as in Yawm Al-Qiyamah. It is an insult to Allah to think Al-Quran speaks only about the past. Every time you face an ayah, they give you a translation about the past, what has happened in the past. No relationship with now. So now we're going to get on how to really work with the Quran to design a better now and an awesome tomorrow. Rule number 1, Quran talks to you in the now. Even if it tells you a tale about what has happened in the past. Even if it tells you a tale about what is going to happen in the future. The purpose of this is that you use the now. For example, if I tell you last year 3 people died on the highway because they drove at 90 miles an hour. I'm telling you last year, okay? And then the research goes on, and they say, if people carry on driving at 90 miles an hour, in 3 years' time from now, we will be having 100 people dead. So I'm telling you about people that lived in the past that died at 90 miles an hour. I've told you about people that are coming in the future that will die at 90. What am I telling you? Now, don't drive 90 miles an hour. Huh?
It's a warning.
Absolutely.
Learn.
Shaykh al-Akhir. This is exactly what Allah means in the Quran. When he talks to us about the children of Israel, He would say, this is what I gave them. I favored them. I gave them the best law to mankind at that time. Instead of them applying it and following it and taking it and using it and da-da-da-da, they did this. Look at them now. That's what Allah is telling us. They didn't do what Allah told them. Look at the children of Israel now. The Christians, same thing. So what is Allah telling us? Don't do like they did. So when He tells us that when they did and they said and they did and they said, it's not a historical thing. It is more last year, 3 people died when they drove 90. And in 3 years' time, 100 people die. Just make sure you don't be of these 100 people. So here, when Al-Quran talks to you in the now, and if you remember from an alive God to an alive human. So every ayah that you read it in the now. Even the birth of Jesus, Allah tells us something that happened in the past. Yes, He's informing us of what happened. Okay? But He is telling us, this is what had happened at that time. But because the people, they messed up their texts, look at what they believe. So make sure that the Quran that you got in between your hands now, you understand it properly. Otherwise, you'll end up like them. Make sense? Make sense. You with me about it? So that's why Al-Quran talks to you in the now. It is from an alive God to an alive human. Point number two, you do not need a tafsir. You do not need a tafsir of the past or written in the past. I don't need a tafsir written 1400 years ago. I don't want a tafsir written by Ibn Kathir. I really don't want to. You know what the tafsir do to us? They turn us into stupid, idiot people. Here is how. When we used to have, before, when phones didn't have memory, when they were just, landlines, you used to know the numbers of your friends, your mother, your uncle, your auntie. You used to know them, right? You pick up the thing and you dial from memory. How many of us now know the number of their wives, their kids? We don't. We don't at all. If you lose your number, your kid calls you and you will find yourself telling him, excuse me, who is this? I've lost my phone. It's strange, right? The brain is extremely, extremely smart, intelligent, powerful. And it loves laziness. If you remember what I said, the brain is powerful and lazy at the same time. It loves laziness. Oh, God. The brain is happy staying all day long in bed doing absolutely not a thing. That's why there is something, an energy inside us that pushes us to use the brain. But anyway, why I don't need a tafsir? Because we have how many books of tafsir do we have today? Gazillions. How good are we Muslims today at working with the Quran? Nothing. Because we have become lazy. Now someone might say, hang on, if we don't have tafsirs, how can we do? We do it exactly at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You understand the Quran, you read and you use your mind, teach you the techniques on how to understand it. And when you don't understand something, you go to someone who knows.
That's the key.
That's it. I don't need Ibn Kathir today.
I was going to suggest that would be dangerous if you try and do it by yourself. You might not understand exactly what Allah is trying to say. And you can take things out of context like we discussed last week.
But the reason why you do that, the reason why, is because they have told you that you can't count from 1 to 10. The scholars today, they tell you Ibn Kathir, this. But I have never seen people teaching you what we are doing tonight. How you can understand what Allah is telling you. It doesn't need rocket science. Really, it doesn't. Quran is simple. Allah has said it's simple. So now I have two parties. One of them says it's simple, and it's the honor of the Quran, and easy to understand, easy to memorize, easy to practice. And on the other hand, I've got people that tell me, no, Al-Quran is too difficult, you can't understand it. You need scholars, you need tafsir. Who are you? Maybe you will understand out of context. So who do I believe? The one who says, this is my book and I'm telling you it's easy? When you look at the book of Al-Quran, anything that will lead you to Jannah is easily understandable by you, by him, by Safwan. Because he's our younger here. If Latif was here, I would have said her. But what I'm saying here, everything that you need, الزِّنَا حَرَام. Allah says الزِّنَا حَرَام. How many tafsir do you need to understand that? السَّارِقَ حَرَام. How many tafsir do you understand that? Backbiting حَرَام. How many tafsir do you understand that? Wallahi, you don't need a tafsir. الطَّلَاق, Allah says, الطَّلَاق مَرَّةً, two times. And the third time you set free. How many tafsir book do you need? But when you go into the books of tafsir, you start getting the headaches. Allah says, as you will see now, Allah says the talaq is two times and you divorce on the third one. And go in the books of tafsirs and you're going to have headaches. When the talaq takes place, when it does this, when it does that, it's unbelievable. Yes.
What about reading tafsir in terms of when the ayahs were revealed and the reason why, is that good on that angle?
Wallahi, you don't need it. Because not all, you see.
Sabab, the purpose.
We don't need it. Okay. Asbab al-Nuzul is an unneeded science. Because the Sahaba, it is impossible that Rasulullah would apply a Quran based on the reasons of revelation. But if I take this one here, this law, and we'll apply it in 100 years, they will come up with another law that today that wouldn't apply. When I started driving, the rules and the laws and the constitution of driving is completely different than what it is today. Completely different. So what I'm saying here is we do not need a tafsir. What you need is, you need the ability to understand what Allah is saying to you. Then, if you don't understand something, you seek those who do.
Now, those who do now.
Yeah, yeah. Remember the law, what I said, the Quran is Allah talks to people, life talks to you in the now. In the now.
The latter sentence, so that means scholars and...
You know, let me tell you something. Do you know what a scholar is? If we have a teacher who teaches math at the university, is he a scholar of math? Or is he just a teacher of math? He's a teacher of math. A scholar of math is Einstein that comes up with a new theory. It comes up with a new law. It comes up. Scholars are those who make up the new things. It's different. Let me give you another example. A driving instructor and those who make the law, they're two different people, right? What we have today, we hardly have a scholar today. We have people who promote their school of thoughts. That's all there is to it. A scholar would be somebody who takes a Quran and he reads an ayah and he goes, yeah, I have found out something here. And this, we can bring this new law, this, and we can apply this law. And this is a scholar. But all this, what you see, Saudi Arabia, these things, I call them the mass production sheikhs. Take them to university, sit them all down, and one person teaches them. They have an exam, you pass. And that's it. What this person is going to do is going just to tell you what has happened in the past. These are promoters of school of thoughts. I call them promoters of school of thoughts. And these people, yes, you can ask them. But you can ask them, because you have not understood it, not to explain to you.
Just one more point. Mm-hmm. When you said you need, what you need is the ability to understand. So that's emphasized. You have to learn Arabic.
Absolutely. You will see, yeah, absolutely. You will see some examples and you will see. Let me take a couple more laws and then. Okay. Number three. So the Quran talks to you tonight. You do not need a tafsir. Okay. Rule number three. You are capable of deriving your own laws from the Quran. Do you know what the difference is between tunnel thinking and open ocean thinking? Tunnel thinking is when if I want you to think in a certain particular way, I bring the notion of what I, and then you will go through that tunnel, you think only like this. But if I want you to open up and think, you go, huh. Oh, this is big, right? So now, you are capable of deriving your own laws from the Quran. Wallah, you are. I'll give you an example, a quick example. One day I was reading the Quran, I was reading Surah Yusuf. And I came to the point where Imra'at al-Aziz, the wife of al-Aziz, the minister or the prime minister, well, she learned Yusuf alayhi salam. And then when he ran away and she pulled his shirt from the back, and they brought a witness, and he said, "In kana qamisuhu qudda min qubul," if his shirt was pulled from the front, fasadaqat, she is right, she spoke the truth, wa huwa min al-kathibin, and he's of the liars, wa in kana qamisuhu, and if his shirt was pulled from the back, fakathabat, wa huwa min al-sadiqin. And I said, subhanAllah, this is Allah telling me something that has happened with Yusuf alayhi salam, something like 7,000 years ago. Why would he tell us the story? We don't even hear, you see? And then I started thinking, where in the world, where do we use this law? Where? Because this is, if something happens from the back, the claimant is wrong, the defendant is right.
Vehicles.
Insurance. Insurance, if you are hit from the back, you are never wrong, right? That's it. So now that law is applied in insurance. If your car is hit from the back, then the one who is going to accuse you is a liar and you are the one who speaks the truth. But if your car is hit from the front, he is the one who speaks the right and you are a liar. Beautiful, isn't it? Now, you see how the Quran gives you a hint and asks you to use this box. That is a law that was applied at that moment there. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you just exactly like Sulaiman alayhi salam. Just like that. And the Quran is full of those ideas. Please take a picture of this, then we're going to go through some examples. If you notice here, I'm liberating your minds to explore.
What was tunnel thinking and what's the other one?
Tunnel, you said tunnel thinking?
An ocean thinking.
Ocean
thinking, yes. Tunnel thinking is very limited. What we Muslims today have, Danahi?
Yeah.
What we Muslims have today is tunnel thinking. But what I'm going to teach you tonight is going to be the ocean thinking.
Is that actually a term? Ocean thinking? I heard of tunnel thinking, but I haven't heard of ocean.
That's my term. That's my... You know when you stand in front of a tunnel, it's claustrophobic and all that kind of stuff. But when you stand at the top of a mountain facing the ocean, how do you feel? We're going to take some examples, inshallah, to wrap up this. Examples between tunnel and ocean thinking. And I want you, my brothers, to open on the last surah, Surah An-Nas, that is 114. The very first thing, when you read it, okay, do me a favor, can you read the English version of it?
Say, I seek refuge with Allah, the Lord of mankind, the King of mankind, the God of mankind, from the evil of the whisperer, who whispers evil in the hearts of men, who withdraws from his whisperings in one's heart, after one remembers Allah, who whispers in the breasts of mankind, of jinn and men.
Good. This, believe it or not, how many times have you read it? قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. But in your mind, it doesn't make no sense. Think of it. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. You seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبْ النَّاسِ, the one who sustains them. Think of it. Malik, the owner of Nas, or the king of Nas. إِلَهِ النَّاسِ is the one who is to the worshipped of people. What am I seeking refuge from? Al-waswas, the whisperer. Al-ladhi, the one who whispers, where? Fi sudurinnas, they say the breasts, but normally it should be chest. But the chest of people. And then what do they say? From?
He whispers in the breast of mankind, of jinn and men.
Hang on. How does he whisper? In the hearts of mankind, and then they say of man and the jinn. Does that make sense to you?
Not through man and jinn.
Mm-hmm. But that is not what it's meant in this surah. I go for the ayah number, the last one, الَّذِي وَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ. It doesn't make sense. Because here what it says, the one who whispers in the chest, فِي صُدُورِ, in the chests of people, and then of or from the jinn and people. مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ. Does it make sense to you?
Are you saying that it doesn't make sense because of where did jinn come from? Why did he mention jinn?
Yeah, he's whispered in the chests of people.
He's saying men.
People. This surah is greatly misunderstood. Here is how you start working with the Quran. You go, الَّذِي وَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ. I go, صُدُور is plural. What is the singular? Sadr. What does sadr mean? Sadr always means forefront of something. The forefront of something. Why it's sadr? When I'm standing and talking to you, what comes, what faces me? It's your chest. Is it your stomach? You understand? See, it's always the chest and the upper, from the chest and up. Also, sadara also equals has been issued. Sadara kitab, for example. If I say sadara kitab, a book was issued.
Another meaning.
Yeah. In Arabic, they say al-waridat wa tasdir, import, exports. So, al-tasdir, sadr, aydan, equals export. What Allah is saying here, that people don't say, and now here is where you understand. عندما Allah says, الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ, i.e. people have other people that are at the forefront. When you have a group of people, what is the person that is at the forefront of people? Leaders, presidents. Who represents France? Okay, if there is a calamity in the world, and you say, من يتصدر لها? Who puts himself first for it? France comes and says, نحن نتصدر لها. The president says, أنا أتصدر. I put myself forefront. It doesn't mean himself, it means his country. So what Allah is saying here is this. Not the one who whispers in the chests of people. No, it's the one who whispers in the leaders of people, okay? And this from, because the jinn, they have leaders, and humans have leaders. So what we are saying, Ya Allah, we seek refuge in you against people when a shaitan whispers to the president, whispers to the top of the police, whispers to the top of the army, and they issue a ruling, and it hurts us all. It doesn't mean in the chest of man, of the jinn of man, and things like that. Now read it with this one here. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ I seek refuge in the رَبِّ النَّاسِ the Lord of النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ the one who owns them, or the king of the people. إِلَهِ النَّاسِ Why am I asking Allah with three of his utmost attributes? As a Rabb, Lord, as a deity worshipped, and the owner of mankind. What for? Because I'm seeking refuge in him that a shaitan should whisper into our leaders and they lead us astray. These leaders, they exist both in the jinn and in mankind. Now, does it make more sense?
More holistic. More rather than something that's more personal.
Yes. Because it's An-Nas, the surah, the name of the surah is An-Nas, people. How come we didn't make it in the individual?
The word breasts is
wrong. Breasts is wrong. Here it means the people who are at the forefront, the leaders. You see, the army. Huh?
The tafsir, because obviously they knew Arabic too. So what did they say about this?
The same what's in there. Always remember, the mufassir, no matter how big they are in knowledge, they are human beings. And the tunnel thinking, because Ibn Kathir says it, and he is a great scholar, it must be right. Then I say it. And it doesn't make sense. I'll give you another example.
And I will stop here. And tomorrow, inshallah, I shall carry on with the third part of the Quran studies with two further examples of how wrong translations have traveled through centuries. And today, they cause us a lot of more headaches than anything else. And until tomorrow, please spend the most wonderful day today and tonight. This is again your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. To join my WhatsApp group or for any inquiries, questions or anything, just please get in touch with me 0044 78 76 40 87 35. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.